50 degrees. It's Thursday, April 7th. Bill DeFosset, WHGR 90.3 News. Huffington Post reports that Russian President Vladimir Putin said a friend of his named in the Panama paper leaks had done nothing wrong and spent the money he earned for business on buying expensive musical instruments which he was donating to public institutions. Media reports based on the leaked documents from a Panama-based law firm allege that Sergei Roldozhin, a cellist and friend of Putin, had quietly built up a sprawling business empire involved in offshore transactions that might be linked to the Russian leader. British Prime Minister David Cameron has admitted that he previously owned a profitable stake in his father Ian Cameron's offshore trust in Panama and may have received money from offshore sources in his inheritance. The Prime Minister and his wife Samantha owned shares in the trust of his late father before selling them for around £30,000 in 2010. Cameron has made four statements since the Panama Papers were leaked and said he does not benefit from any of the funds involved. DNA Info reports four high-ranking NYPD officers have been disciplined in the midst of an FBI investigation into corruption, Commissioner Bratton announced today. The high-ranking cops stripped of their badges and guns in the investigation headed by the NYPD's Internal Affairs Bureau. Bratton said the FBI and Department of Justice became involved in the inquiry. The investigation is examining the conduct of current and former NYPD officers and several others. Bratton said NYPD cops in the rank of captain and above will receive additional training regarding conflict of interest rules. An NYPD source says that the officers were all in high-profile positions. Cops aren't supposed to accept outside gifts worth more than $50. FBI investigators are also trying to determine if former Chief of Department Philip Banks improperly accepted gifts from Reichsberg, including a trip to Israel. The wide-ranging inquiry traces its roots to Manhattan U.S. Attorney Preet Bharara's investigation into Norman Seabrook, the powerful boss of the City Corrections Unit. Multiple sources said that Seabrooks and Banks are close friends. Hillary Clinton hopped aboard a Bronx number 4 train this morning and took a shot at her old school rival Bernie Sanders in the process. As Clinton swiped through the turnstile at the 161st Street Yankee Stadium station, she referenced Sanders' much-mocked comments to the Daily News, revealing his mistaken belief New Yorkers still use subway tokens. By the way, Senator Sanders, tokens were officially phased out in 2003. Clinton then boarded the train, turning the car into a complete madhouse. Secret Service agents, photographers, reporters, politicians packed the train, surprising riders who snapped pictures with their phones. She only rode two stops before disembarking at East 170th Street. With a crowd of folks following her, she walked into a breakfast and burger joint, Munchtime, with Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz. John Kasich was campaigning on Arthur Avenue in the Bronx. Presidential candidate Cruz was blasted by Bronx residents and politicians yesterday during a visit to the borough over his attack on, quote, New York values and his immigration stance. Mayor de Blasio said that with the New York primary playing an unexpectedly crucial role in the nominating contest, the Texas senator's tactics will come back to bite him. De Blasio said Cruz, who has bashed him and Police Commissioner Bill Bratton over their stance on Muslim surveillance and has attacked De Blasio on charter schools and a host of other topics, is welcome to disagree on policy. The Nets lost to the Wizards. The Knicks lost to the Charlotte Hornets. The Yankees are currently playing Houston Astros and are down by one. The Mets win over Kansas City. It's currently 50 degrees. A wide-ranging variety of weather we've had today. Mostly cloudy. The low will be 43 overnight, with the continued possibility of high winds and rain. As many as 3 inches of slushy snow could fall on the city Saturday, forecasters said. The wet snow is expected to begin starting about midday and continue through the night. Stay tuned for more information here on WHCR. Bill DeFawcett, WHCR 90.3 News. Next report at 9 o'clock. Bulletins or alerts at any time. And now back to you.
What we're gonna do now is go back.
Take it all his dream. What does it mean? He wouldn't know. Can't be like the rest. It's the most he'll confess. But the time's running out and there's no happiness. Oh, Superfly, you're gonna make your fortune bye-bye. But if you lose, don't ask no questions why. The only game you know is do or die. Try. another chunky plan, pushing dope for the man. A Fed is on the corner now. If you wanna be a junkie, why? Remember, Fred is dead.
Has its own radio station.
WHCR
90.3 FM. The voice of Harlem.
This summer, the City College of New York invites you to keep ahead of the course load. Summer at City is peak season for earning credits towards your degree. With classes taught by renowned faculty, over 300 courses to choose from, and three affordable sessions being offered, what better way to beat the heat? To register, visit City online at ccny.cuny.edu. Registration ends July 4th. Spend your summer at City.
WHCR is proud to have Viatex and Document Prep as an underwriter. Viatex, located at 600 West 139th Street between Broadway and Riverside Drive. Viatex is available to assist you with income tax, life insurance, immigration, translation, divorces, and notary. For hours of operation and more information, email viatex1040@gmail.com or call 212-926-5697.
Good evening, Harlem. Welcome to Harlem Beat, a community affairs show produced by the radio journalism class here at the City College of New York. I'm your host, Greg Hagel. Some of our reporters hit the street to cover some issues they felt were important. Tonight, we'll talk about safety on the MTA, Stacey Dash and her anti-black comments, anti-feminist comments, why Bernie Sanders is not getting the black vote, black protest songs, and how they reflect society. But first, my man Chris has a few headlines.
In international news, according to Democracy Now!, Puerto Rico's governor Alejandro Garcia Padilla signed an emergency bill allowing the government to halt payments on its $72 billion debt. Padilla says the bill plans to protect the health, security, and public welfare by using government funds first and foremost for public services. A group of hedge funds sued to freeze the assets of Puerto Rico's government development bank to stop the bank from spending money on the island that the hedge fund wants to go toward upcoming debt payments. Now relations between Puerto Rico and these hedge funds grow tense as major debt payments in May and July bloom. Nationally, Republican candidate Senator Ted Cruz and Democratic candidate Senator Bernie Sanders won the Wisconsin state primaries. All five presidential candidates now have set their sights on New York State, which is scheduled to hold primaries on April 19, 2016. John Kasich, Donald Trump, and Ted Cruz will all attend the New York Republican Gala on April 14th. Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton are set to square off in a debate on April 14th in Brooklyn. In the local news, First Lady Michelle Obama will be the first keynote speaker at City College's 170th commencement graduation ceremony. She will deliver the commencement address on the City College of New York South Campus Great Lawn on Friday, June 3rd, 2016 at 10:30 a.m. in historic Harlem, where more than 3,000 students make up the class of 2016. This has been Chris Machen for WHCR 90.3 FM. Back to you, Greg.
Thanks, Chris. Secretary Clinton represented New York. Thanks, Chris. Secretary Clinton represented New York in the Senate and has a large percentage of the black vote. But Senator Sanders recently drew
a large crowd, which included blacks and Latinos, when he recently visited the Bronx. Andrew has more.
Cheers rang out for Senator Bernie Sanders on Thursday night as he became the first presidential nominee to visit the Bronx in over 35 years. ahead of the New York primary on April 19th, Sanders held a massive rally at St. Mary's Park in Mott Haven, drawing more than 18,000 enthusiastic supporters.
We need somebody new. Like, we need a change. Like, the whole United States, we just need a change. You know, just tired of the same old things, you know? Just time for something new, something refreshing, something we ain't never had before.
Throughout his whole entire political career, he's been, I think, the most consistent, you know, in terms of equality, LGBT rights, civil rights. That just made me think, like, wow, okay, this is a guy throughout his whole life he's been fighting for equal rights.
Despite this massive show of support from his base, the numbers show that even with his recent wins in several primaries and caucuses, Senator Sanders still needs an estimated 56% of the remaining pledged delegates to overtake Secretary Clinton. Currently, Clinton maintains a polling lead of roughly 20 points due to the overwhelming support of African-American voters. Secretary Clinton addressed this point in a speech she gave in Harlem last week.
Let me just give you a short summary of where we are. I've competed across our country. I am honored to have received nearly 9 million votes. That is more than a million that Donald Trump has received. And 2.5 million more than Senator Sanders. So we're on the right track.
Reading the tea leaves and perhaps polls that show that 60% of African Americans support Secretary Clinton, Senator Sanders has begun to tailor his message to address black issues. From promoting policy.
This campaign is listening to our brothers and sisters in the African American community. And they are tired of having their kids go to broken down, inadequate schools. They are tired of sky high unemployment rates. They want, and I want, major investments in inner cities throughout this country.
To securing high-profile endorsements like this one from Spike Lee.
We have to talk to our parents, because the old generation, they're on this Clinton thing, and we got to talk to our older parents and get their mind right.
Senator Sanders even released an ad this week featuring Erica Garner, the daughter of Eric Garner, who died as a result of a police chokehold on Staten Island 2 years ago.
This is everything that I have, my family. I got to see my dad die on national TV. They don't know what they took from us. People are dying. We need a president that's going to talk about it. I believe Bernie Sanders is a protester. He's not scared to go up against the criminal justice system. He's not scared. That's why I'm from Bernie.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
Regardless of the campaign's uphill battle to reach new voters of color, his supporters remain surprisingly optimistic.
We need a different kind of leader, you know, not the same old politics and rhetoric and, you know, just need a change. I would personally like to see what Bernie Sanders can bring to the people of the Bronx, Manhattan, to the world, period.
This is Andrew Chandler for WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Thanks, Andrew. Despite the dramatic spike in New York City slashing attacks and robberies, one woman continues to ride the subway. Betty has the story.
According to New York City's Metropolitan Transportation Authority, better known as the MTA, it is the largest public transportation system in North America and one of the largest in the world. With a daily ridership of 5.6 million people, it is the most convenient form of transportation for an everyday commuter like Christina Park.
I reside in Staten Island, so I commute to Manhattan every day for work. It's really convenient, especially if you're living in a different borough. It's probably like the quickest form of transportation that's out there. You know, traveling in the city, if you were to use a car, is just way too like inconvenient.
According to the MTA, while crime rates dropped in New York City to an all-time low in January 2016, random acts of slashing and robberies on the subway dominated headlines in February and March. Felony crimes in the subway have increased by 35% and assaults have nearly tripled from 11 to 31 since 2015.
Scary to hear about those things, but it's also very real. I feel like it can happen to almost anybody, whether or not on the subway, like inside the train or on the platform, it can happen to anybody. So it's really just being careful and paying attention to the people that's around you, because you know millions of people use this train system every day, and it's just so much traffic that sometimes it's, you know, you don't know who's on that train with you.
With 3,600 subway cars traveling 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, commuters may find themselves unexpected victims to random acts of violence.
A month and a half ago, my phone was stolen while I was on the train to work, and I'm sitting in this seat that's right next to the door, and I'm texting, and right before the door closes, somebody just snatches my phone. Before you know it, the doors is closed and the train is moving. So it's definitely, when something like that happens to you, it makes you really think twice about what you're doing and how you kind of really have to pay attention to your surroundings a little bit more. Me, out of habit, I'm so engulfed in my phone sometimes, I never even saw that person coming.
Fears about public safety are nothing new on New York subways. Enclosed subways make commuters feel helpless against potential attackers. However, most New Yorkers don't have a choice.
There's no viable alternative that would be better than the MTA in terms of convenience. It's something that's just so incorporated in my life that I've gotten so used to it that it's just like, for me to cut that out and using something else, it's, I mean, living in the metro area, it's almost impossible. You know, like everything that's happening on the news, it really makes you kind of pay more attention while you're riding the subway. A lot of things have happened recently and it's getting worse.
Mayor de Blasio has announced a new plan to have a police officer patrol every subway train at night to prevent the public's fears over the underground attacks. The MTA board is working with the NYPD to bring additional security measures to the subway.
They always have the messages over the speakers on the train to, like, you know, not expose any jewelry or put away your cell phones when you're on the train. I just feel like growing up in this age, it's just almost impossible to kind of take that advice and be like, okay, I'm gonna put my cell phone away every single time I ride the subway. It's definitely effective to some extent, but I think that not a message is gonna teach you how to be more careful. It's something that you have to kind of take upon yourself to pay attention to people around you and just be smart about things.
This is Betty Wu for WHCR 90.3 FM, New York. According to New York City's Metropolitan Transit.
Thanks, Betty. Stacey Dash is clueless about the plight of African Americans and women, and she's getting backlash for anti-everybody comments. Celeste has the story.
Other than her role in the 1995 movie Clueless, Stacey Dash would have faded into the annals of one-hit wonders in 90s movies if not for the derogatory remarks she has made about women and African Americans. From her controversial statements regarding the ban of hard liquor at Dartmouth College in an attempt to reduce the number of sexual assaults on campus.
It's a good thing for the good girls, you know, to be told, stay home, be safe. The other bad girls, bad women, are the ones who like to be naughty. Might go out and play and get hurt, and then, you know, but the other thing about this is that it then blames the alcohol instead of the person who overdrinks. So, you know, it's like the same thing with guns. Guns don't kill people, people kill people. Alcohol doesn't get you drunk, you get yourself drunk.
To her heated discussion with TV host Meredith Vieira.
Rita Wilson, she spoke out in a new video about gender inequality in Hollywood, DC, and in Fortune 500. Companies, and I know that you took issue with what she said. Why?
Well, because I feel like it's an excuse. Right.
But I feel like we're fighting an uphill battle when you look at the numbers. We make 78 cents for every dollar that a man makes. Mm-hmm. There's something wrong. Something clearly wrong. I don't know that it's just, you know, us not taking responsibility. We're not given the opportunity.
Well, I feel like that if it, I don't know if that's true. I really feel like if you
that's
are
true. That's documented.
I know that the numbers are
right,
true.
Right.
But I don't think us, you know, complaining about it, because there is a law passed that we get paid equal pay.
Except we don't. But we don't.
Dash has managed to hit a nerve with women and most recently the African American community. This year, she surprised attendees of the 2016 Academy Awards by walking on stage as the new Academy Director of Diversity Outreach, a fictitious position presented to her by host Chris Rock.
It's hard to get a job, and that's, you know, it's rough out there for black actors. But let me tell you some good news. The Academy has taken steps to fix this problem, and that is why it is my honor to introduce the new director of our Minority Outreach Program. Please welcome Ms. Stacey Dash.
I cannot wait to help my people out. Happy Black History Month. Thank you.
Her appearance certainly deserved an award for most awkward in Oscar history, receiving no applause from the confused audience. Her Happy Black History Month comment poked fun at the backlash she received for vocalizing her disapproval of the celebration on Fox News' Fox with Friends with Stephen Dossie.
We have to make up our minds. Either we want to have segregation or integration. And if we don't want segregation, then we need to get rid of channels like BET and the BET Awards and the Image Awards, where you're only awarded if you're black. If it were the other way around, we would be up in arms. It's a double standard. Just like there shouldn't be a Black History Month. You know, we're Americans, period, that's it.
Are you saying there shouldn't be a Black History Month because there isn't a White History Month?
Exactly.
Viewers immediately took to social media to vocalize their opinions about Dash, some labeling her as ignorant, clueless, and stupid beyond belief. Dash clearly needs a history lesson. Black History Month was started by Carter G. Woodson in 1926 because the contributions of black people were left out of history books. Woodson said in his own words, "We should emphasize not Negro history, but the Negro in history. The case of the Negro is well taken care of when it's shown how he has far influenced the development of civilization." Public relations specialist and pop culture enthusiast Dominique Chaplin echoes Woodson's sentiments.
I definitely think her appearance was staged for a humorous effect, but I think she made a mockery of Black History Month and African Americans and all that they've endured in the United States. If you even have superficial knowledge of American history, you know the trials and tribulations that Black Americans have endured in the United States. I think Black History Month is necessary. I think they're still underemployed, they are underpaid. And unfortunately in this country, White History Month is every month but February.
Chaplin feels that Dash is resorting to making negative comments because she lacks talent.
I think her comments will keep her in the limelight. I think behind closed doors, people don't consider her a worthy actress.
This is Celeste Rivera for WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
We got this. Hold on, I'm going bowl alert.
Thanks, Celeste. We will take a quick break. Stay tuned.
Welcome to WHCR's Community Calendar, keeping you abreast of events in Harlem and throughout the tri-state area. The following events will take place from Thursday, March 31st to Friday, April 8th, 2016. On Thursday, March 31st, from 6 p.m. to midnight at MIST at 46 West 116th Street between Lenox and Fifth Avenues is the MIST Afro Jam Mixer. WHCR's own DJ Soul of Atun, host of the Harlem Dance Party House Music Show, will be the DJ. This event is free, and to RSVP, email afrojamevents@gmail.com. On Friday, April 1st at 6 p.m. at the Bronx Museum of the Arts, the 17th annual Havana Film Festival kicks off with a screening of La Rumba Me Llama. The movie follows the development of rumba through interviews with its most emblematic practitioners. There will be a special performance by Melvis Santana and the Ashiti Project. This event is free, and for more information, visit hffny.com. On Saturday, April 2nd at 7 p.m. at the National Black Theater is the first of three performances of the Epic YTF, the Youth Theater Festival. Epic YTF is the culmination of the award-winning youth development program, Shakespeare Remix. These students fully debate the social and political questions of the play, decode the meaning of Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew, and weave their own writing into the fabric of the script. For ticket information, visit epictheaterensemble.org. On Monday, April 4th at 6 p.m. at the Imagination Raw Space is the Harlem Liberation School. The presentation topic is Don't Get It Twisted, The Power and Importance of Black History. They provide a Black Community Learning Center for political education, developing grassroots organizing, and create a space for informed political discussion. This event is free, and for more information, call 347-806-9384. If you have an event that you would like to place on our calendar, please call 212-650-7481 or email communitycalendar@whcr.org. Submissions must be made 3 to 4 weeks prior to the event. This is Huma Saida for WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
You are a waste. A loser. Everyone hates you. Why don't you just stay in your car and keep driving? I'm serious. Drive until you run out of gas, then get out of your car and walk until you find someone who doesn't think you're dumber than bricks. Could take a while, but at least all that walking might burn a couple of calories.
You may not witness bullying like this every day. Your kids do. They want to help, but they don't know how. Visit stopbullying.gov to learn safe, simple ways your child can help stop bullying. Be more than a bystander at stopbullying.gov. A message from the Ad Council.
The Community Emergency Response Team, or CERT, of New York City, provides assistance in preparing and recovering from emergencies. CERT assists first responders and provides staffing for city shelters in response to disasters and extreme weather conditions. City College is one of the many locations for hurricane evacuation. CERT team members are local and live amongst the community, so they are always there for the people. CERT members will speak to any organization about emergency planning for the elderly, children, and the disabled. They offer workshops in creating go bags, emergency communication, and evacuation plans, and shelter-in-place kits. To learn how to prepare for emergencies, call South Harlem CERT at 917-406-6661.
Hey, we back. So now we're going to have a little discussion. I want to ask the panel here. Are you concerned about the slashings on the MTA? Who here is concerned?
Well, I mean, I feel like we should all be concerned because we all take mass transit. I feel like, you know, at one point, especially with technology being such a big thing now and everyone flashing their new iPhones and their Beats headphones, and, you know, we should all be concerned. It's sad that we have to, you know, hide our electronics and be to ourselves and not be able to enjoy our commute. But, you know, in the world that we live in,
slashing, somebody taking my iPod, two different things. So, what would your concern be, and what do you think the city is there doing enough, or they're not doing enough?
I think they're doing enough with their campaigns about just being aware of your surroundings. I think that if everyone was aware of their surroundings, that it would make a big deal. I also think that slashings and, you know, taking someone's iPod, is they go hand in hand, because if someone is not willing to give up their valuables, then they might get really hurt.
But like Betty said in her podcast, there was a situation where somebody was sitting there holding their item, and before the door closed, it was snatched.
Well,
so it's kind of, you're trying to help yourself and save your items and just still looking in your phone. We live in a social media area, you know?
Well, I mean, as far as, like, piggybacking off of what you were saying about, you know, politicians doing enough, or regardless of what they do, there's only so much that you can prevent. I mean, what are you going to do? Put more cameras on the transit, you know, in the train stations and on the buses? Like, how does that necessarily prevent someone from being slashed? If you see somebody coming after you, where are you going to run? In the tracks to the other end? Like, there's only so far that you can go. How can you really prevent something like that from happening?
I don't know if you can prevent it, but for me, it's a hood and a hat. What about you, Chris?
Well, I know that
In about an hour and a half, I'll be taking the MTA home, and my back will be against the wall. You know what I'm saying? It's just, I'm not ready to take a chance, you know, with all these slashings going on. It's just not right. But the campaign and Mayor de Blasio have taken the right steps in the right direction to put police officers on these trains where these slashings are happening. I mean, you can't put in a number on when it's going to happen, where it's going to happen. But at the end of the day, something needs to be done, and de Blasio's doing the right thing and putting staff onto these trains.
I definitely think that there is a lack of police, that there's a lack of police stations in the trains.
I agree.
I don't see them as often as I do, only around like big events, or so I think that they need to increase.
Okay, now we'll talk with Nicolette Natten discussing the intersection between music and protest music.
Music reflects the society we live in. Protest music has been a catalyst over decades to invoke socio-political change. Dr. Timothy Mangan and Professor CCNY's Black Studies program takes us through decades of Black protest music. He says, songs marchers sang during the Civil Rights Movement had roots in slavery.
People in the South who were following King's nonviolent movement, they were practicing nonviolence, but they knew that they were going into really violent situations. And they would have to have some kind of strength if they were going to do it. So they really drew on their own heritage and on their own tradition, which are Black spirituals. And those Black spirituals, these are the songs that African Americans use to persevere during some of the most horrendous times in American history.
The 1970s gave us Gil Scott-Heron, one of the first singing poets to report on the conditions Blacks were living in worldwide. His songs also predicted social change.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised.
The revolution will never be televised. Winter in America and Johannesburg, all songs of protest and the black unity, but also holding black people accountable for what's going on. So he also gave an insider perspective. He said, yo, you guys know what's up. You guys know what up. You know what we have to do to fix things and how we got to move forward. And these are songs that you can also sing along with. These are poems and works that you can also sing along with. So that's another reason why they're also really, really powerful.
Heron's style of storytelling had an impact on what would later be called rap music.
Like our founding fathers, those early MCs were, especially Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, who did the first message rap that actually described what was happening on the street. So they were influenced by Gil Scott-Heron.
It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under.
Public Enemy's Fight the Power, released in 1989, bears the same name as a 1975 hit by the Isley Brothers. Both songs reached number one on the charts, and Public Enemy borrowed their line, "We gotta fight the powers that be," from the Isley Brothers' hit.
Smile is in the making. We gotta fight the powers that be.
Fight the Power didn't use that kind of harsh language, but it was a harsh sound. It was a powerful sound, and it was really creative and gifted, kind of in the Gil Scott-Heron mode, without using a lot of profanity. And that was like the anthem that I remember that was pretty, I think that Public Enemy was pretty much right chord at the right time and the right vibe. They were very militant, and that underlying that militancy was a recognition of the power of the Nation of Islam, because they were on the back cover of Fight the Power, recognition of Africa as something to be proud of, and that's where we came from. And it was talking about black power, which is what we grew up underneath, very much aware of racial pride.
Gotta give us what we need. Hey. Our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the powers that be. Fight the power.
True to the legacy of their forefathers, Artists such as Kendrick Lamar, Janelle Monáe, and J. Cole have used music as an instrument for change to amplify the Black Lives Matter movement, both on and off digital media.
So that's a positive thing, but as well, it kind of diffuses the power too. And it's the media or the technology that people use to listen to the music through YouTube and earbuds, instead of turning on the stereo and listening to the songs that way. So it's really heartening when you have songs by Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole, and even going back, Diamonds Are Forever with Kanye West. So right now with Black Lives Matter using songs like All Right as part of their chants, we're there.
With politically charged songs like Hell You Talking About, Janelle Monáe has used her platform on TV and online to call out police brutality in the Black community.
She's really taking on the mantle of promoting Black pride and justice. Through her actions in creating an enterprise, singers, songwriters, composers, and producers. She also promotes Black music through her preaching about it. So on a recent live gig at the Today Show, I believe it was, she began to talk about how Black music can be a force for social change and that we need more equitable justice in this country and the pride of Black music. She started doing that during her performance, and the network cut her off.
From the 1960s to present, it has been taboo for artists to get involved in sociopolitical issues. But in her performance at the 2016 Super Bowl, Beyoncé set off a firestorm of controversy when she paid tribute to the Black Panthers, who were a force for positive social change in the Black community.
Like a lot of artists, especially with hardcore hip-hop, rap, mainstream rap, where everyone's singing about money or just trying to make money regardless of how they're presenting themselves and how they're presenting Black people and the idea, and it's all about just getting money. It's really refreshing to see top artists going out and protesting. So Beyonce freaking people out and saying, oh my God, she's dressing like the Black Panthers. Well, the Black Panthers were such a great positive influence on the neighborhood. And these racist people are talking about the Panthers as if they're some kind of horrible militant organization. They fed people. They provided medical care. They provided dental care. They arose because the police were slaughtering people of African descent in their community. So when these vets and African Americans took advantage of the right to bear arms and to monitor the police in their neighborhoods, it changed things.
Rapper Kendrick Lamar also used his platform at the 2016 Grammys to shine a light on the prison industrial complex.
I'm African, I'm black as the moon. Heritage of a small village, part of my residence. Came from the bottom of mankind. My hair is nappy, you know that it's big. My nose is rounded wide. You hate me, don't you? You hate my people. Your plan is to terminate my culture. You know you're evil, I want you to recognize that I'm a proud monkey. You vandalize my perception, but cake takes down from it. And this is more than discussion. I mean, I might press the button, so you know my discretion. Caught in my feelings, I know that you feel it. Step inside my community, making a killing. You made me a killer. Emancipation of a real hitter.
So when he came out on the Grammys and he was in chains and he was dressed like a prisoner, he is addressing the incredible, horrible situation of mass incarceration. And even if the folks who want to emulate hip-hoppers were trying to emulate his style and craft, it was unmistakable about what his message was carrying out because of his prison garb, his wonderful and amazing articulation of the message. And his performance was just off the hook.
Although lyrics are what we often remember about songs, Dr. Mangan says that we may be most affected by the instrumental composition of them.
We got to remember the instrumental sound. It's really just as important, if even not more important than the lyrics. That carries through. The sound has meaning, and it's in our bodies from what we heard growing up. We need to remember that when we think about the power and the impact of the music.
Music and political activism have been intertwined for decades to spread messages about the community, hope, unity, and change. According to the legend Stevie Wonder, music is a world within itself. It is a language we all understand. This is Nicola Nanton for WHCR 90.3 FM.
Thank you, Nicolette, and thank you for listening to Harlem Beat. Tonight's reporters was Chris Machen, Andrew Chandler, Betty Wu, Celeste Rivera, and Nicolette Nanton. Our board operator was Carol Commission. The radio journalism class is taught by Professor Angela Hardin. I'm your host, Greg Cagle. Thank you, Harlem, and good night.
Veterans have difficulty transitioning their military skills into civilian jobs. In New York City, an estimated 17,300 veterans are unemployed. Are you a veteran in desperate need of help? Do you want to take advantage of a life-changing opportunity? If so, the 369th Veterans Outreach Program is designed to assist veterans in Harlem and surrounding communities. Veteran services include resume preparation, interview workshops, access to interview attire, and reliable transportation. For more information, call the 369th Veterans Outreach Program at 646-533-9292.
The third annual Celebration of International Jazz Day is Saturday, April 30th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. International Jazz Day is the culmination of Jazz Appreciation Month, which draws public attention to jazz and its extraordinary heritage throughout the month of April. There will be a reception, an arts exhibit, a multimedia presentation, a panel discussion, and of course, great jazz. At the center of the event is an awards presentation honoring WHCR's jazz personalities. That's the third annual International Jazz Day, Saturday, April 30th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. at the Dwyer Cultural Center, located at 258 St. Nicholas Avenue at West 122nd Street in Harlem. In celebration of WHCR's 30th anniversary, WHCR membership card holders will receive a $5 discount off theater seating. For tickets and more information, call 212-222-3060. That's 212-222-3060. This summer, the City College of New York invites you to keep ahead of the course load. Summer at City is peak season for earning credits towards your degree. With classes taught by renowned faculty, over 300 courses to choose from, and three affordable sessions being offered, what better way to beat the heat? To register, visit City online at ccny.cuny.edu. Registration ends July 4th. Spend your summer at City.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Maurice Selby.
And this is Sean Shivers.
Let's heal together by tuning into our show, Health in Harlem, every Thursday night at 7 p.m., where we interview healthcare professionals who will give you free medical advice.
Yes, that's free medical advice. We will discuss various ailments that affect your quality of life.
We will show you how you can afford to get treatment without emptying your pocket.
And I guarantee you will have learned something by the end of the show.
Armed with this life-saving information, all we ask is that you share it with friends and family.
That's Health in Harlem every Thursday night at 7 p.m. on WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
The voice of Harlem.
The voice of Harlem.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
It's
waves and colors, poison them against their sisters and brothers, yes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the listening audience. I am Maurice Selby.
And I am Sean Shivers.
And I'm Ayanna Cole.
And you're listening to the one and only Health in Harlem on WHCR 90.3 FM New York, the voice of Harlem.
The voice of Harlem.
And welcome back. First of all, I just got to say welcome back to my colleagues.
My brother.
My family.
My sister.
Yeah, oh, my gosh,
while,
man.
It's been a while.
It's been a while. And yes, we've been making some structural changes here at WHCR.
I was stressing
and
I'm so sorry.
It kept us off the air live at least for some time, but we are back, and you know, of course, the quality in addition to the renovations, the quality will never change, so we're going to bring you some more great information. And we actually have two veterans of the show to bring us back into our rhythm here on Health in Harlem. And ladies and gentlemen, welcome Roger Milliner. He is the Deputy Executive Director of Marketing for Metro Plus Health Plans. And also Mr. Victor Bell III, also a veteran of the show. He is the Associate Executive Director of Marketing. And tonight, we are updating you on the Affordable Care Act and also some changes in recent new products release and developments in Metro Plus. So welcome back to the program, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
And it's always our pleasure to have you guys.
It's so funny that this topic, from all the controversy, and I'm going to call it controversy, that has been going on with this new campaign, the political system that's going on right now, this is going to be a very, very important topic for people who have health insurance.
Well, look at it. We're in like the height of the primary season pretty much, and you guys are right on time. So right. I'm glad that you guys made it. So update us. We're 3 years in. You guys have been here sure. numerous times with updates, even when it was when things really started to take place, or the major changes in 2014. You guys were here talking about that. So where are we in terms of the Affordable Care Act? Is this something that's working? Do we need to make changes? And what are you guys seeing in Metro Plus?
Well, that's a great question. And first and foremost, thank you again for having us and actually calling us veterans of the show. It kind of made me feel special in the political season here. We're doing it. But overall, so you know from the history of these marketplace actually starting in 2013, going to 2014, and the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act actually goes back to 2010. In the beginning of it, you know that there was a lot of myths about whether or not this was actually going to work and how many people actually wanted it, and if people were really going to go to an online marketplace and actually go there to obtain health insurance. And we're very pleased to come here today and let you know from a national standpoint that the programs have been very successful. You know, you have those different state-run marketplaces and the federally run marketplaces, and overall we've seen some improvements over the last couple of years, especially from in 2014, going from 2013 to 2014, there were 7.2 million fewer people left uninsured nationwide. And then moving from 2014 to 2015, there were 16 million people that were fewer uninsured across the country overall. So when we get that asked the question of whether or not this is working, you know, absolutely. A lot of the marketplaces have made it more accessible for people to go in, and they've been better to get more information out to the public and make things able to communicate to individuals at a level that they would really understand. So in our partnership with New York State and providing this health insurance, you know, Roger will provide some of the statistics on the successes there, but New York State has been a banner state in regards to providing health insurance throughout the country and has been recognized on several platforms for it.
Gotcha. I want to ask a quick question. Sure. Just kind of throwing a bone in the whole conversation real quick, because I know that a lot of individuals is thinking about this. When you look at TV, CNN, all the news channels, they talk about how the people running for office, the Republicans, they keep saying the worst thing that Obama ever did was create the Affordable Care Act. Yeah. And a lot of people is hearing that, and when you hear something so negative, you start to believe it. Is there a reason why they keep saying that? Can you kind of answer that question at all?
Well, to take a stab at it in general, you have a lot of myths that are out there. You have it that people are now being forced to provide insurance for their employees when they didn't want it anymore, and how people's insurance plans were impacted and they liked the old one. And what Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act did was bring up the value level and the quality of the benefits that were there through the 10 essential benefits. And that was a mix up that a lot of people didn't really understand, that the insurance that they had previously wasn't of the quality to which should be a standard. And a lot of people actually took that and ran with it. And especially for Metro Plus Health Plan, anytime that we were out in the community, it was something that we definitely wanted to speak about. And facts are facts. Look at the numbers. You know, you're talking about 16 million, 7.2 million people that previously did not have health insurance that are now having affordable health insurance. And, you know, you hear all the things about Canada and these other locations with coverage and everything like that. So when you ask me personally, and I have to speak for myself mm-hmm. on this one, whether or not this was the worst thing that Obamacare, ask the people who have insurance now that didn't. Whether or not it's the worst thing that they had. And, you know, political campaigns, they're going to do what they want to do. They have certain people pushing them, certain people that they're going to try to make happy. And if this wasn't on the agenda, you know, what better way to attack it?
Correct. And also, too, I think, you know, from my point of view, I think that when you tell somebody that they must do this or they have to do this, or if it's against the law and if you don't do it, you'll be penalized. Yeah. That causes a lot of controversy, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Now, this is a controversial question.
Sure.
You know, and this is the reality of things, and is that a lot of people look at this legislation as a quote unquote handout mm-hmm. or a giveaway to insurance companies. Mm-hmm. And you gentlemen, as insurance executives, mm-hmm. how do you feel about that? And how has the legislation either helped you guys provide the services that you do? Or even has it hampered you in any way? And how do you view the legislation from your roles as executives at Metro Plus?
Well, I wouldn't say that it's a handout because in one way, if we don't take care of the citizens of New York or the Americans, you're going to deal with them in another way. It'll be an epidemic if people don't have the insurance that they need to pay mm-hmm. for health care. So it's either deal with the problem on one end or you're going to deal with it on the other.
True
so
story.
By you know, providing people with health care and access to health care, you're helping to minimize the amount of, you know, bigger illnesses that you could be that you're preventing from happening and causing, you know, worse health care outcomes that you're going to have to deal with and cost more money.
Of course.
So I think, you know, like anything else, if you treat things up front and everything about the Affordable Care Act is all aimed at preventive health care.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. We speak about prevention all the time. So if you're really using health care the right way and you're getting insurance and insurance companies are being held to these high standards of preventive medicine, then what you're doing is preventing, you know, further and worse outcomes that you're only going to have to deal with later on. That's going to cost a lot more money to taxpayers and everything. So in my opinion, I think that, you know, dealing with it up front, addressing it up front is a much better way of treating
it. It's an investment, essentially. And that's the way I was looking at it.
Right. And then I was going to mention, too, as far as value-based purchasing, as far as individuals out there who have Medicaid and Medicare services, mm-hmm. if you are consistently readmitted into the hospital, especially if you have congestive heart failure, something like mm-hmm. that, the hospital is not going to be reimbursed. So you make a very good point as far as the preventive medicine. If you continuously come back to the hospital itself, especially if it's a public hospital, is not going to get paid or reimbursed by the government.
And you're looking at taxes in regards to trying to make up those losses as well. And if you want to look at it from a health plan or a company structure, you know, we're regulated to make sure that whatever funds that we bring in, a percentage of it goes back to treating the actual patient or the member. So, you know, one of the things that the state wanted to make sure was that at least 80% of the revenue from this went directly towards care and not towards the pockets of the big companies or the blue chip companies. And you know how previously with political campaigns, whatever the case may be, people talk about taking the money and buying jets.
True
and
story.
All these different types of stuff.
Cars
and so we're regulated continuously. And for Metro Plus, we just want to make sure that we provide quality care. We've been doing this for, you know, we just celebrated our 30th anniversary. So we've been doing this for a pretty long time and providing these type of products. So from a health plan perspective, for us at least, we've been dealing with government-sponsored care for a long time. Mm. A lot of commercial plans are now getting into the business because of the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare and going into the marketplace. But for us, we're still delivering the care.
And I guess that's how would you distinguish yourselves, from these other insurance companies in that you guys are actually under the health and hospitals, mm-hmm. New York City Health and Hospitals, correct? So how does that differ, Metro Plus, maybe compared to other insurance companies?
Yeah. Well, we have a very long track record of providing great customer service and quality to the residents of New York City as well. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, you know, when you look at our rates, we're the lowest on the marketplace at providing this coverage to the individuals who are eligible for it and providing the premiums for them and the subsidies that they can actually arrange with. I'm speaking about health and hospitals. You know, the largest healthcare system in the country is our parent company. So our ability to outreach to the community and get into the right segments of people who need this care, we have tremendous access to it in order to work with community partners. And we just had a couple of meetings where we gave out awards to community partners who have been working with us to recognize them as well. And we're the plans on these shows. You know, we come out, we make sure that we stand out amongst these other competitors, and our products have a lot of non-standards.
I want to add to what Victor's saying. I was actually going to say this at the tail end of our radio show, but I'll bring it up now. We are doing a lot to make Metro Plus even more improved. We want to come on the show and let you know that we recognize the importance of healthcare for all New Yorkers. So we recently did a product a territory expansion. We're now operating in all five boroughs. When we were on the show the last time, we only operated in Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, and the Bronx.
No Staten Island.
but Metro Plus, you know, felt that it was very important, and we worked with our regulatory agencies, and we worked with all the contracting requirements, and we're now a health plan that's offered to Staten Island residents. Mm. And we saw a tremendous welcoming of our health plan. Yes, the products. January 1st is when we started operating in Staten Island. And the residents of Staten Island were so appreciative. They said, "We've been waiting for you to come here for a very long time." Mm-hmm. They always saw us on the marketplace, but never was able to choose us because we weren't an option for them. And so when they found out that we were now a health plan in the marketplace in Staten Island, and they could actually switch plans because we had a more affordable product, we had a large network, we had all of these other type of care management programs, we saw a great a reception, and a lot of people enrolled. So we did a territory expansion into Staten Island. Mm-hmm. We also, since the last time we were on the show, expanded our Metro Plus Gold product. So we have a product for the 40,000 employees of the New York City Health and Hospital Corporation. Mm-hmm. We took that product and expanded it to all city employees. So if you're a police officer, a fireman, you work for the Department of Education, you're a correction officer, sanitation, any city employee now has the option to choose Metro Plus Gold as a product of their offerings as well. So we're proud of this. This is our way of showing that we see value in all of these different subsidized programs, programs for the uninsured, programs for city employees, moving into new service areas. We are doing a lot to make our member experience better. We've created a member portal. Mm-hmm. So now our members can actually do a lot of things that they would have had to call into our customer service department in the past for. They can do online from the comfort of their home, such as request a new ID card, change their address, see their claims and their billing information, pay their bills online,
find providers.
So creating a member portal was something that our members were long waiting for and said, "Wow, I now can do a lot of my self-service stuff without being, having to go online, without having to call in
and waiting on the whole."
I was about to set it also too, because that gives the having that portal, it gives the patient the power.
Yeah.
What do you always say,
Mo? Empowerment. Oh, advocates. You can be your own
healthcare advocate.
Your business.
Correct.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Health in Harlem on WHCR 90.3 FM New York. We are going to take our first break for the evening. Remember, you can call in at 212-650-6903. That is 212-650-6903. I haven't been back in a while,
okay,
man. You're listening to Health in Harlem. We will be right back. Stay with us.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
If you know the symptoms and get the facts, you'll know the signs of a heart attack. Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if it sounds familiar, call 911.
Pain in your neck, chest,
arms, or jaw,
shortness of breath,
please tell us more. Cold sweats and nausea, tiredness,
it's time to take it serious.
Back pain, stomach pain, shortness of breath, cold sweats, nausea, dizziness. If you know the symptoms and heed the signs, you'll be around for a long, long time. Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if any sound familiar, call 911.
Learn a song that could save your life. Get a free download at womenshealth.gov/heartattack.
Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if any sound familiar, call 911. If any sound familiar, call 911.
A message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
911. Hey, there he is. How's it going?
I'm having a stroke.
Are you going to shake my hand or what?
I'm having a stroke.
Wow, you're not even moving your arm.
I'm having a stroke.
Are you okay?
I'm having a stroke.
Your face looks weird too.
I'm having a stroke.
Are you having a seizure or something?
I'm having a stroke.
When someone is having a stroke, they may not be able to say it with words, but their body language will tell you loud and clear.
I'm having a stroke.
You just need to know the sudden signs. Look for FAST, F-A-S-T. F, face drooping. A, arm weakness. Or S, speech difficulty. Then T, time. Time to call 911 immediately, because the sooner they get to the hospital, the sooner they'll get treatment. And that can make a remarkable difference in their recovery. Know the sudden signs. Face, arm, speech, time. Spot a stroke fast. Visit strokeassociation.org. Brought to you by the American Stroke Association and the Ad Council.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Welcome back to the one and only Health in Harlem, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Maurice Selby.
And this is Sean Shivers.
And I'm Ayanna Cole.
And ladies and gentlemen, tonight we have with us from Metro Plus, actually, I guess affiliated with Harlem Hospital, if you will, Mr. Roger Milliner. He's the Deputy Executive Director of Marketing at Metro Plus Health Plan. Also, Mr. Victor Bell III. He's the Associate Executive Director of Marketing, also at Metro Plus. And we are talking about the Affordable Care Act and also Metro Plus and how it is working within this legislation. But I want to say it's like muscle memory, man. I'm like trying to figure out where the buttons are, but
that's
I'm letting
it last week
flow right now, man. Woo, feels good to be back on the air. But when we went to break, we were talking about one, how now over 7 million people more access to medicine or to good quality health care.